know.
Today, we connect with theatre company Trickster as they go digital.
Not a single instant had we ever thought that we would actually create a residency where we weren't even in the building.
Next, we check out a surprising art installation at Loft 112.
For me, it was the ability to kind of step out of my comfort zone and challenge myself artistically.
And finally, we get ourselves moving to a South Asian beat at Soul Feet.
It's a part of who we are.
This and more on Living a Creative Life. I'm Adora Wolfor, and today we're doing live theater in video format, checking out what's inside the box, and dancing with a Bollywood flair. But first, we check out what's on the socials. Maya Corona reminds us of the unconditional love between pets and humans. Green Genie shows us a different kind of mask wearing through some surrealistic chorus performance art. A Tea Cozy is a Sometimes is weaving their way through to something beautiful. And Zach Polis will be exhibiting their photography at Contemporary Calgary in 2021 in the Emerging Photographers Showcase. Trickster has always been a unique and innovative theater company. Let's find out how they've reinvented themselves to keep kids' creativity flowing.
If someone had said 6 months ago, by Christmas, you're going to have to create a completely digital residency, I would have thought that's space talk. Trickster Theatre is a company that builds work with children in schools. So we go into a school for a week, they choose a theme, we build an original show with up to 600 performers in a week, and we supply the artists to direct and produce that project. So we have 30 artists that we work with, and so we teach them that process. They bring, of course, their own skills and their own knowledge to things as well. My job is to create mechanisms that enable other people's creativity. That's really what Trickster is doing.
Plastic bottles.
It's a great program. They have a lot of fun. They all get to be on stage. They all get to help in the invention of the show. Working with a set of pool noodles, doing physical motion and telling a story through those pool noodles. However, now, in COVID, we're not doing that. So we've put that whole thing aside and reinvented what we do as telling video stories. So we basically just purchased some huge, well, seemingly huge 30-foot by 30-foot green screens, the lights, all a whole bunch of new sound, and all the artists are in a 3-week training program to learn how to use that equipment. So in the end, we'll make it look good, it'll be relevant, and it'll be fast. I started it in 1980. I was just out of clown school in Mexico, and I had a show I had made down there. And then 2 years later, my wife Cheryl Chantler joined me. So then together, we toured schools, communities, and festivals. And that then led us in the late 80s into the residency program and the structure that we invented to make that work. Not a single instant had we ever thought that we would actually create a residency where we weren't even in the building. So it's really changing the face of the company, and I don't think it will go back. I mean, that door has been opened of opportunity to create digitally delivered work. Yeah, sci-fi, overnight. Amazing.
We all know that creativity doesn't fit in one certain type of box, but what if at Loft 112, it did?
I'm Lisa Murphy Lamb. I'm director of Loft 112. It's a literary creative space, and we've been around for coming up 7 years.
Loft 112, personally, is probably my favorite place in Calgary, aside of my home. My name is Stacey Wallachow, and I'm a visual artist here in Calgary, and I am also the manager of opportunities. knowing that we had this vintage card catalog at Loft, it just seemed pretty cool that it would be an opportunity that we could present to local artists.
There are 30 drawers by 30 plus artists. And each drawer has something to discover. Some with the red dots, you can just open and look. And with the green dots, you can actually take out and read and experience. Here's Paula Timms, a bit of wonder from a child's perspective and a bit of a surprise. This is Taylor Van Eyck, and this investigates her European and Métis heritage. Julia Hagnoski, welcome to her reading room. Both watercolor and embroidery by Linnea Martina. Mark Giles has his collection as a celebration of his mother's collection when he was a boy. Sue Vasoli is an artist, and she sat with her grandchildren, and they each expressed what COVID, living during COVID times, was like for them. This project allowed people to express themselves how they wanted to at their home or their studio. But then because it's all housed in this tiny space, next drawers that are next to each other, it was an expression of community as well. We don't put a lot of stipulations on what an artist can create. So there was no theme, it just had to fit into the box.
Myself, I've never done anything that wasn't on like wood panel or canvas. So for me, it was the ability to kind of step out of my comfort zone and challenge myself artistically. So this drawer I have done in tribute to The Yellow Wallpaper by Charlotte Perkins Gilman. It is a short story. It was published in 1892. Though it is not a happy tale, I was fascinated with the story, and through quite a battle with postpartum depression, the story kind of was replaying in my mind. And unfortunately or fortunately, it's still such a relevant story today. The main character is this woman who has had a child. She's left in this room with this hideous wallpaper. Everybody thinks that she's ill, and she goes mad. It kind of leads you to believe that she might be suffering from postpartum. It's just an interesting tale or story to slowly see how keeping people isolated and in the dark and without help just perpetuates this problem to where it's a disaster. So in the frame is the very last line of the story. And so she says, "Now why should that man have fainted? But he did. And right across my path by the wall so that I had to creep over him every time." I am proud of this. Again, just really proud to have an opportunity to start a conversation about art or story.
The owner of Dance Studio Soulfeet is sharing their love of South Asian dance with everyone and encourages anyone, regardless of ability, to give it a try.
Did you to decide to open up your own personal studio? Because, you know, a dance studio is not an easy feat.
I think it was more out of desperation and sadness. I had grown up dancing, and the studio that I danced at closed overnight. And it was really traumatizing, I think, to both myself and the people around me. And so I made a business plan that night and decided that I was going to do this because people deserved to experience dance the way that I did and have a chance to explore that part of their identity. We are a Bollywood dance school, and we incorporate different styles in with a Bollywood flair.
So when you think about Bollywood, normally you think about the movies and the song and the dance and bright costumes, but it's really an amalgamation of all different dance styles. So doing jazz and lyrical contemporary hip hop is not a far off stretch, and it has that Indian flair by incorporating the classical elements of dance that you see.
How does your prosthetic affect or lead how you are living a creative life within dance?
It was through that, that my mom introduced me to dance when I was little, and she was really looking for a creative outlet for me to learn about myself, both internally and externally, and to kind of gain some of that confidence. And dance very quickly became everything for me. Through our work here at the studio, we do have a class that is designed for dancers that do have needs of any kind. So whether that's physical or mental, they're more than welcome to come here. Disability is defined by what you choose it to be, and so for some people, disability is just not seeing what ability you actually have. So I don't think that it's anything that should stop people from exploring dance.
For all of us, this is our side hustle, our passion project, and this is the one thing that is that common thread between all of us and something that we feel so strongly about.
How did you manage when your studio was not open during COVID-19?
So we moved online and started offering Facebook classes through closed groups and then moved to Zoom.
We had to adapt very quickly, like Shaliza said. We closed overnight and in fact had classes 2 days after that and needed to figure it out right away. Our students matter to us, our classes are everything to us, and so getting that together and figuring it out was, we have to. There was no other option. The thought of not doing it didn't even cross our minds. It was like, how can we do this? Despite the barriers of being physically apart and even through the screen, it was amazing to see how connected everyone felt. And I think we're so proud of both of our Canadian heritage and our South Asian heritage, and being able to keep that culture alive through dance as part of it is something that we don't take lightly and we feel so strongly about, and it's really, it's a part of who we are.
Thank you to the dancers at Soul Feet for showing us such a unique dancing style. And thank you, all you creative Calgarians, for showing us your variety of talents. Now, if you know somebody who's living creatively here in Calgary, please post to submissions@calgaryartsdevelopment.com or with the hashtag yycLCL. See you next time on Living a Creative Life.